Hi, Sam. 20 fights, 17 wins, 11 knockouts. British, European, Commonwealth bronze. Amazing career. Why is it now? Why is now the right time to retire?
I just feel like my performances can't match where I see myself. Even in training, I wasn't reaching what I'm used to, what I expect of myself. I just couldn't cut it anymore, and I feel like I'd rather leave now and quit now. Why? You know, I've only lost to three good opponents, really good opponents. I don't want to lose to anyone with a less standard or people I feel like, you know, I really shouldn't lose to. So get out now. I've still got my health. I've got my kid. Got my kid now at home as well. So I want to have all my faculties when I'm raising him. So yeah, definitely the right time.
What would you put that decline down to? Would you say age or just being in the game a bit too long, or what would you say is?
Yeah, a bit of both. I think maybe my peak was probably, I should say pro, maybe 2014 after I won a Commonwealth bronze. 2014 was my best year in the amateurs. I reckon I was one of the best in the world at that year. And I should say pro then, but I stuck at amateurs. I think that took a lot out of me. And then, yeah, turning pro, just, it was a long career. And then COVID took my peak years as a pro. I reckon I just beat Joel Hughes in 2020. And I didn't box again for another year, and then COVID was happening. I only boxed like once or twice in them three years, and yeah, it was just wasn't good enough, and just caught up with me.
I said you've achieved a lot in your career. What would you say like the highlight is of your career? What's your biggest achievement?
As a pro,
yeah,
as a pro. Obviously winning the British title against Hakeem, but I think my biggest win was against Joe Hughes. I think a lot of people, I know Joe Hughes maybe was on the tail end of his career, but he was a massive name. He just had a fight with Robbie Davis. It was a close fight with them. And so I think a lot of people wanted to see where I was, and that really showed that I deserve to be up there. And so that goes down to my biggest win, I think. But my most memorable thing is winning the British title against Hakeem. That moment I was unreal, and I've got the pictures and memories that are going to last forever. So yeah, happy days.
You're probably most famous for the last minute knockout of Sabri Sedri,
Sedri.
Just tell us a bit about that fight and how your life changed afterwards.
Oh, yeah. So, like a lot of my fights, I was supposed to line up to fight this guy called Dotel. I think he's from Holland. Belgium. He was a good opponent. Like, he's got a really good record. He's had some great fights. And so we trained for him. He had like a orthodox kind of style, similar to me. High hands. Big puncher, so like we prepared for that. We had some good sparring, and the training was perfect. And then a week before, it fell through. Another month before it fell through, and that show had to get cancelled. Then they postponed the show to the next month in March. And we had no opponent. Didn't get an opponent till a week before. And all I knew was it Sabiri, this French kid. He looked like he got a few knockouts, but I just thought last minute replacement. It's going to be an easy win. Like nothing. Wasn't worried. And then yeah, just. I underestimated him. Like I remember going to the weigh-in, and we weighing in. I was just doing like I normally do. I've only been boxing journeyman, so I was like not really that intense at the weigh-ins. And he was just intense, and I was like thinking, "Now this kid really, really wants to win. Think he thinks he's gonna beat me." I remember thinking that in my head. I was like, "Wow, he's on it. He seemed very confident." And so that already woke me up a little bit. And then obviously the first round, he knocked me down first round, and that really woke me up. I thought, "Wow, this is a fight." But I had no intention of losing it, and I didn't. But like you said, like I was saying, though, we prepared for this orthodox strong puncher and very textbook. And then Sabiri was complete opposite. He was hands down. He was all over the place, but also a massive puncher. So it was just completely opposite of what I was expecting. But I dealt with it. I think it was good that because as well, that whole venue, I only sold maybe 200 tickets, but the whole venue, there was like say 3,000 people in there. By the end of the fight, when I got that last minute second knockout, it erupted. Everyone wanted me to get that punch and land that punch. Probably playing for the whole fight, praying for that moment, and it happened. And so I was like in the ring thinking, wow, this is amazing. But I still didn't expect how mad it would have took off worldwide or virally. Obviously, till I got home, I was just like, wow, it really hit home with some people. Like, it was massive. It just blew up. Millions of views. I think it got on Twitter, millions of views. And every now and then it still gets replayed on all the channels and on the YouTube.
So apart from in your professional career, is there anyone you wish you fought or like a fight that didn't materialise that maybe not all the fans will know about?
I've never had to really think about that. Or I haven't thought about that for a while. I feel Yeah, maybe, yeah, maybe like the likes of, there was a few Liverpool clashes that could have been really good for me anyway, because to build my reputation, but some, they were a bit ahead of me with their reputation, yeah. I think, but like Tom Farrell, Robbie Davis, yeah, them two, maybe just them two, big massive names, it would have been brilliant for Liverpool, good fights, and so maybe a bit glad that I didn't get that local rivalry with anyone.
You finished your career where it started at the Solly.
Yeah.
How important has this place been to you for your journey?
Unreal. I'm back home, and it's just a bit, obviously I don't want to have regrets in my career, but also in my head I do think I would have loved to have been here throughout my whole career. Things might have been differently, gone different, but that doesn't mean things would have gone better, it would have just been different. But I love that I finished here, started here, finished here, with people that around me that want the best for me, and just a great move for me.
Your amateur career, what would you say your biggest achievement there is?
Winning the ABAs, whether that be the first year when I first came to gym with Berkey and Jimmy Carroll and ran JJ Metcalf, Adam Farrell, like that was, what a year. Andy Coulhoun, it was a great year. That was massive as well, because I proved to myself I'm this good enough to be here. But then also the second time I won the ABAs with Eddie in my corner, and we boxed Josh Kelly in the final, that's also a massive win, because that got me my place on the Commonwealth game. So yeah, them two moments with the Solly, my whole career, that they were my favourite moments in the amateurs.
Another famous moment in your amateur career is when you boxed Lomachenko twice. What was it like sharing the ring with like a legend of that like stature?
I don't think you can understand it till you're in there with him. He's phenomenal. Like, he knew what I was wanted to do before I even knew I wanted to do it. Like, the first round as well, he just was done throwing feints. He didn't do nothing to him. He was just throwing feints, and I was like reacting. I was worked really hard. Like I feel like I won the first round in both the fights, because I was throwing loads of shots. He didn't throw nothing. But then the next round, he knew when I do this feint, Sam's gonna do this, and it just counted me. It was unreal. And I wasn't supposed to fight him the first time. I was supposed to fight this Rudenko. We watched tape on him. I was gonna beat him easy. And then last minute, they changed it. Brought Lomachenko in. A bit gutted, but I'm glad I got to fight him. But then again, I wasn't supposed to fight him 2 weeks later in London. It was supposed to be Josh Taylor. It was supposed to be Nevin, a lad called Nevin, really good Irish boxer. He pulls out. Josh Taylor's supposed to fight him. Josh Taylor gets injured the week, fight week. And so it has to be me again. But I'm glad I did box him the second time, because I did a lot better the second time than the first. But it's like, how lucky is that? But it's my claim to fame. Yeah. Lomachenko twice, not many people can say that. In WSB as well, it's more like... get out of you. He just loved the camera, this guy, and that's all. He needed cameras on.
Would you say he's the best you've shared the ring with?
100%, yeah, 100%. Best to share the ring with, and I feel like in the first fight as well, I by the last round, in the fourth round, I got dropped with a body shot, and then got up and then got through it. But last round, I feel like he could have stopped me if he wanted to, and he didn't. He just helped me get through it. Do you know what I mean? I feel like that's what I really feel like. Like, because he could have, he was far better than me, and I was tired, I had nothing left, and he just helped me get through the round. I think that's what kind of person he is. He's that good, but also he's just a nice guy. Like, I can't explain it. He's a true champion.
Okay. What is your plans for after boxing now? So obviously you're still involved with this gym. Is anything like?
Yeah, obviously I want to get into helping out with Eddie with the amateur side of things. But I moved straight into doing some PT and a bit of coaching, and it's helped me transition. Like, I was thinking it's gonna be horrible not being able to be boxing. Boxing's finished. But it's like I've not left. I'm still here, same lads. Still being in the gym every day. So it's good for my mental health. And we'll see how that goes, though. I feel like I'm going to do really well. And then I'll move into the amateur boxing. But if not, then I'll just go and get a normal job somewhere, become a civilian or something. I don't know.
You're really involved with Kurt Wiggins and Lewis Molyneux.
Yeah.
What can you tell everyone about them too?
Just keep an eye on them. These lads are positive lads. They're motivated. They want to do well, and they're going to do well, I feel, and they're in a great place to do it. They've surrounded themselves with a good team, and they're going to be exciting. So yeah, keep an eye out for them, definitely.
And final question: what advice would you give to a young Sam Maxwell starting his career?
Young Sam Maxwell, like I said, I don't want to dwell on my regrets, but just maybe speak to people who have been around the game before I make my decisions. I should have conferred with people like Eddie and Berkey. to get their advice on what I should do moving forward, rather than just blindly trust people because I'm quite maybe too trusting, a bit naive to it. I would just trust people because they're being nice to me, and I made some mistakes doing it that way. But other than that, no, I'm happy with where I got my. In my career, but definitely if I went to a different gym, had different managers, different promoters, I might have enjoyed my boxing better, but I might have won the British title and the Commonwealth title. That happened because of the path I was on and what I did, so I would never change it. So yeah, Sam, just yeah, be happy. Like, I remember being a kid thinking I'd love to be in this position I was boxing on TV, boxing the world champions, elite level names, and I got to a British title, Commonwealth title, and then WBO European. If I could tell the young me, you're going to achieve that, I'd laugh at myself because I wouldn't believe it. And I made it. And yeah, I just want to say, keep plugging away, keep doing it, and you'll reach your dreams, definitely. That's what I'd say to me anyway.
Congratulations on a great career, Sam.
Cheers. Thank you.
Cheers. Yeah, let's see how you do under pressure. Oh.